Lock tight on the bolts up here, and that's something I may do later.
Oh, yeah, that's true.
Says that a man sharpens the countenance of his friend. It's me, what? Hey guys and gals, Steve again, Live to My Path Outdoors. Wanted to have a little short talk, a little Bible devotional or whatever you would like to call it. You just saw the chickens there going after their water bucket. As I mentioned the other day, we're in the process of moving, still going back and forth between two houses. So sometime this later in the day before we can get over to them, and they've been out of water for a while, their bucket was dry, and as soon as I put it in there, they come running to it. I just brought a scripture to mind, Psalms 42, verse 1. David is writing some of this story and say that this is when he was in exile, running from Saul. Some say running from his son Absalom, but either way, he was in dire straits. And he wanted to return home to Jerusalem. But he says, as the hart panteth after the water brooks, so panteth my soul after thee, O God. My soul thirsteth for God, for the living God. When shall I come and appear before God? And he says, as the hart panteth, it's H-A-R-T, which he's talking about a deer. I guess that's why the chickens brought that to my attention, about animals getting thirsty. When an animal gets thirsty, that's the one thing on their mind. They're not distracted by other things in their life like we are. We get one thing on our mind, turn our head, and another thing pops in. But when an animal is thirsty, their main concern is to get water. And that's what they do. They don't stop concentrating on finding and getting water until they get water. That's what David is talking about here. As the hart panteth after the water brooks, so panteth my soul after thee, O God. It was a yearning and a longing that David was feeling to feel God and to get back home to Jerusalem and the city of God. And that was the only thing on his mind. That was all consuming. It was what he was thinking about constantly. Now, whether we want to admit it or not, whether we know Christ or not, we all inside of us have a yearning for God, a yearning to reconnect with the Creator, the one who formed us, made us. Unfortunately, we don't always recognize it as that. You'll hear the term a gaping hole inside me, or something's missing from my life, or there's just that one piece of puzzle I can't find that would make me complete, make my life complete. So what we as sinful creatures do is we look for something to fill that void that will never, ever satisfy it. David knew what he needed to be satisfied. He needed to feel God. We will try to fill that void with whatever we can find. We'll use money. If we use money, then how much? How much does it take to fill that void and that longing inside of us? Admiration from other people? How much? How many accolades and awards and trophies can you get before that void is filled? Greed, sex, alcohol, drugs, possessions. You know, you may have 40 cars and you'd still be saying, well, if I just had that 41st car, or five different houses, well, if I had that sixth house, that's all I'd need, I'd be complete. Now, there's nothing wrong with wanting things and trying to obtain them. That's not what we're saying. But if you're trying to fill that hole that you just feel that you just can't seem to complete yourself, there's that one thing missing, and you've went through many relationships and can't find it in any of them. You've owned everything, or you've had lots of cash, or you've had people's praise come up on you, but nothing just seems to fill it up. That's because that gaping peace in our hearts can only be filled by one thing, and that is Christ. Now, we go back here to where David is talking about thirsting, and compares thirsting of a deer for water to how he feels for God. Let's jump over here to John, the book of John, the Gospel of John. I'm dropping papers everywhere. And Jesus speaks of the same type of thing here. John chapter 4. Now remember, David relating this to thirst. It's something we can all understand. Excuse me. John chapter 4. It's something we can all understand, something we all know. When you're thirsty, you want something to drink. And that's the only thing that's going to quench your thirst. If you're dying of thirst laying in a desert somewhere and I give you $10,000 cash money, you're still going to be thirsty. If I give you a bag full of diamonds, you're still going to be thirsty. The only thing that can quench that thirst would be something to drink, and as David speaks, water. So in John chapter 4, starting in verse 4, we're not going to read it all, but just refresh the memory a little. This is when Jesus was traveling through Samaria. It's in the middle of the day and it's hot, and he comes to a place where there's a well, kind of in the town center, and he just sits down on the well. He's sitting there resting, cooling off a little bit, and the Samaritan woman comes up, and she starts talking to him a little, which was odd to begin with, because Jews and Samaritans did not congregate together or get along together. But when she comes up to draw water from the well, he says, "Give me something to drink." And it takes her back, you know. She says, "What are you asking me for? You're a Jew, I'm a woman of Samaria, we're not supposed to even talk." And in verse 10, Jesus answered her and said, "If thou knewest the gift of God and who it is that saith to thee," in other words, if you knew who I was and knew what God could give you through me, "give me to drink, thou wouldest have asked of him, and he would have given thee living water." Well, that just confuses her. She has no idea what he's talking about. She says, "You don't even have a bucket or anything to get water out of there with." Said, "You know, how can you have living water?" And he answered her and says, "Whosoever drinketh of this water shall never thirst again. But whosoever drinketh of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst. But the water that I shall give him shall be in him a well of water springing up into everlasting life." Now Jesus wasn't talking about he had a glass of magic H2O that would make your body never long for water or need water or thirst for water again. He was talking about the gift that he could give her. And he called it living water, the gift of eternal life. Now, not just eternal life, but that connection with God that Jesus brings and brought then. He was comparing the same thing we just talked about. He was comparing trying to fill a spiritual void with something of the natural. He said, "Whoever drinks the water out of this well, this natural water, well, they'll thirst again and they'll need more. But once you take this living water that I have, you'll never thirst again." And it's the same as us trying to fill that void that we may feel inside of us that everyone feels. I'll go ahead and say that. Everybody feels a need for something, and we don't recognize what it is at times. But when we try to fill that void with natural things, like he said, the water from the well, then we're going to thirst again. Like I said, if you have 40 cars trying to complete yourself and make yourself whole, then you're going to want 41. You say, no, 40 would be enough. Well, how come 25 wasn't enough? How come 15 wasn't enough? You had to keep wanting more and more. You were thirsting again. But if we fill that void with spiritual living water, it doesn't matter about all the other stuff. It doesn't matter how many possessions we have, how many relationships we have, how much money we have, how many people admire or adore or like us or any of that. What matters is we fill that void with this living water of Christ, and that's the relationship that we would always have. The void is finally filled. The puzzle piece is finally in place. Now, the only way that we can fill that void with Christ is to accept him into our life. We can't go out and buy him at the Wally World or a Ford dealership or anything like that. You can't go to the bank and pull him out of the ATM machine. And just like you looking for all that natural stuff to fill that void, nobody's going to force it on you. Nobody's going to come and give you 40 cars. You'd have to go get them. Well, it's a little simpler with Jesus. Nobody's going to force him on you. But you don't have to go get him. You just have to accept him. Believe in your heart. Speak it with your mouth. Let him come into your heart. It'll fill that void. I'm telling you from experience, it's not something I read in a book, which I did read in this book. But it's experience. And this book, the Bible says, if you've not experienced that, then you won't believe it. You may not believe it. The difference it'll make in you. I know I was raised in church my whole life. Knew a lot of the Bible, knew what it said, but I hadn't accepted Christ. So even though I believed what it said, I didn't know just how fulfilled you could be. And until you do, you won't. So that's why they call it faith. It's not just faith in believing in something you can't see. It's a step of faith to see if you can get something that you don't really know if it's there or not. To get that fulfillment, to get that peace, to get that joy, to get that contentment that comes with Christ. So if you are searching for something to fill that hole, that void, for that missing puzzle piece, and you've tried all the other things, know now that the one thing that would make you complete is Jesus Christ. Don't dilly-dally in things that can take you out of this world. I know many. I know many that aren't with us anymore, that were very close to me. And I know of some of them before that happened, that in their own way, they said they were just looking for something. You know, I just don't feel anything else to do besides this. Well, when they did this that one last time, that was it for them. So I urge you to look into Jesus. Whatever you're searching for, whatever you think you're searching for, that's the one thing that's going to fill that hole. So we thank you guys for watching. We're not sure the quality of this one, how it's going to be, look, sound, or whatever. This is the first time in our little home office that we've done one of these, but that doesn't matter. We thank you for watching. We really hope and pray that this reaches out and touches someone. Share it if you already know that peace and that contentment. Share it to someone that you know that may not know that. And not saying that this is the perfect video or devotional or anything. Add on it yourself. Go witness to them yourself. Just feeling a really hard pull to speak more about salvation and how important it is to not only for eternal life, you know, we hear that all the time, and it's the truth. eternity in heaven with the Father, you must accept Christ. But this life here, while we're still here, can be so much more with Him because He provides that connection with the Father. So, thank y'all for watching. Really pray this does some good for someone. You can always hit us up with a message on YouTube or find us on Facebook. My name is Steve Justice. Find us on Light Into My Path Outdoors. If there's ever anything that you'd like to speak of that you don't want everybody to know, send me a message. We'll talk it out. If I don't know the answer, we got the cheat sheet. And I know a lot of other people that we can talk to and figure things out. Do not hesitate, if you are having troubles, to seek someone out that will give you some good Bible-based Christian advice. And that's not putting Christians on a pedestal. It's just saying Bible-based. You know, a lot of people will take it and say, well, you're saying Christians are better than such. No, that's not it. I'm saying the Bible is the best place to look for advice. So thank you guys. Hope you join us again. If you have any comments, suggestions, let us know. Any future topics for devotionals or anything else that you'd like to see, let us know about that too. Thank you. Have a good one. God bless.